Dolores, who was behind Vikir, joined her hands and began to use her power, causing a powerful golden energy to appear around her body. And thanks to this, Vikir's body began to emit an aura similar to that of a sword master. Seeing this, Dantalion couldn't help but clench his teeth tightly and take several steps back. Dolores, who had her eyes closed and was focused, started blushing as she could feel the sadness for the loss of so many children and the anger against the demon who had made such a sacrifice. She shared the feelings of the Blood Knight Hound. She began to imagine a knight holding a sword and a saint praying. The Pope of the Church had once said that a saint could awaken upon meeting her true soulmate. She clasped her hands and began to gather divine power. The energy gradually became more intense as she was willing to give all the divine power she had to the knight Bloodhound. A powerful surge of divine power began to emerge from her body. Soul resonance was a blessing that temporarily maximized the target's abilities. She passed her divine power to her soulmate. Vicar's gaze, thirsty for revenge, fixed on the demon. He wanted to kill him at all costs to avenge all the children in Perry. Dolores closed her eyes and began to concentrate even more, while on the other side, Vikir, who had unsheathed the Beelzebub sword, started staring intently at the demon, ready to attack. Now that she had passed her divine power to him, she realized that he was Vikir, and in the moment when he first awakened as a master of the sword, was called Supreme Realm. Dantalion took several steps back and upon seeing our boy's powerful aura, his eyes filled with fear. He couldn't believe that Vikir was a master of the sword. He panicked and began sweating like crazy, remembering that among humans only a few chosen ones could reach that level. And even if it were just as a precautionary target, it would only be heads of prestigious families. Vikir clenched his fist tightly and with a piercing gaze began to walk toward the demon. Dantalion couldn't believe that a boy like him had been able to reach the level of sword master at such a young age. Seeing Vikir upside down, Dantalion's eyes filled with confusion. He was somewhat incredulous, asking why he was upside down, but the reality was that it was his head that was upside down. Vikir had cut off his head without him even noticing. Our boy started unleashing a chain of powerful slashes towards him, which began cutting his body into pieces as if it were mere straw. In the blink of an eye, Vikir cut Dantalion's body into pieces, and his head, which now no longer had tentacles, struck the ground forcefully, causing him to clench his teeth tightly due to the intense pain. Just before he could comprehend what had just happened, Vikir approached him and stomped on his head. Now that the souls he had collected had been purified and disappeared, he no longer had extra faces, having no choice but to fight. Vikir began to observe him intently with a piercing gaze, knowing that the demon must now be feeling useless. His eyes filled with fear, he began to feel a terror he had never felt before. He had not noticed the presence of Vikir's attack at all, wondering if he was really going to die. Vikir began to step on his head even harder and started savoring the moment. Dantalion began watching him and clenched his teeth tightly due to fear, and upon seeing his murderous gaze, he started sweating like crazy. His mission was to gather magical power to open the door to the world of demons. He had thought that soon he would be able to easily conquer the human world. But he had never thought there would be a human who would interfere with them, the demons. He had to kill our boy, even if it meant giving up his own life. Vikir prepared to deliver the final blow, but at that moment his gaze filled with surprise as he noticed something. Dantalion's face began to deform, making several mouths and eyes appear. With a smile, he asked why Vikir believed he no longer had more faces. His head started to mutate and became gigantic. He began staring intently at Vikir with an aggressive gaze, revealing that he still had a face hidden up his sleeve. Vikir immediately withdrew his foot. He couldn't believe this. Dantalion was planning to explode and take Vikir and this orphanage with him. Upon hearing this, Dolores opened her eyes and her gaze filled with surprise. She panicked, realizing that this aura was very dangerous as she felt tingling on her skin. She didn't know what to do now since at this rate the entire area was going to be devastated by the explosion. Vikir remained calm and asked her to calm down as well. Seeing what was in front of her eyes, she was shocked. The demon prepared to explode, being sure that our boy would not be able to do anything about it. While our boy's body was surrounded by the aura of a sword master and divine power, he turned towards Dolores and with a determined gaze said there was nothing to worry about. His eyes were full of determination as he had confidence that he would be able to defeat the demon before it could explode. Now he had achieved the state he had yearned for all his life but had not been able to reach before regressing. He began to recall the moment when Hugo had even cut through the clouds in the sky with his sword. Now he possessed the same power his father had shown. Dantalion decided it was time to end this, and he asked his demon brothers to please complete the mission, swearing that the era of destruction was going to reach the human world. His face began to deform, preparing to explode, But just at that moment, our boy used his power, and remembering his father's sword, launched a powerful slash toward the demon's head. Vicker's attack was so powerful that it cut through the roof of the orphans' dormitories, and not long after, a powerful explosion occurred in the area. Upon hearing the sound of the commotion, Bianca and Sinclair took off the sheets and woke up, wondering what was happening. The explosion created a great earthquake that shook the entire area. Piggy and Tudor woke up in panic, wondering why an earthquake had occurred, while on the other side, Sancho was still half asleep. Dolores, who had her hands together, eyes closed and was blindly trusting Vicker, remained silent. Several seconds later, she stopped praying and opened her eyes, and upon seeing what was in front of her, it made her expression change. She couldn't help but be left open-mouthed. She couldn't believe what her eyes were seeing, and not long after, she fell to her knees on the ground. In front of her was Vicker, with his knee and hand resting on the ground. Our boy's attack had cut through the ceiling of the dormitory and left a large crack in the floor. And just like his father, it had sliced through the clouds in the sky, revealing the starry heavens. Sinclair looked to one side, and her eyes filled with surprise. She opened the window and was shocked since she didn't know what was happening. Vicker's attack had cut through the clouds, revealing a beautiful sky. The incident that occurred at the Indulgentia orphanage in the middle of the night caused the royal capital to be engulfed in fear, and another terrorist attack at an orphanage of the Quavati's family. Like the previous incident, the night bloodhound had been identified as the culprit, and a large crowd had gathered at the scene. Vicker's attack had even destroyed many houses in the area. Many investigators gathered in the area, and upon observing this, Bianca was somewhat surprised. She would never have thought that the night bloodhound would come to an orphanage like this. Behind her was Sinclair, who had her hands resting on her abdomen with a calm gaze. She mentioned that it was frightening for a terrorist attack like this to have occurred where they were. Piggy put on the backpack, and couldn't help but start to feel fear, remembering that many things had happened the last day. Tudor began to observe the crowd with a furious gaze, clenched his fist tightly and couldn't help but feel frustrated since he had wasted an opportunity to catch the Night Hound and prove his qualities as a great hero. With a serene gaze, Sancho mentioned that it was a bit strange since there were no victims in the explosion. Upon hearing this, Piggy, who was somewhat surprised, turned towards him and with a serious gaze asked him to be careful with his words. In front of them was Dolores next to a man. Both began to move away from the area. Piggy started watching her and explained that Quilty, the director of the orphanage, had disappeared along with his escort knights, believing that he had been a victim of the night bloodhound. Sancho's attention fixed on them, and he began to think silently. Once Dolores and the man moved away a bit, she placed her hand on her elbow and, with a lost gaze, began looking at the ground. The man placed his hand under his chin and began thinking. Thanks to her, he knew that Quilty was guilty. He had always thought Quilty was a guy with many oddities, but never that he could be a demon. He moved his hand away from his chin, and with a serene expression, began to turn his head to one side. According to what he knew, the person who had solved the problem had been the Night Bloodhound. Attacking a certain part of the family was an unforgivable act, but for him, it was refreshing to eliminate the rotten parts of the family. They approached the entrance where there were several reporters. The man was not sure if the public would believe this. Dolores remained silent, thinking for several seconds until she turned her back on the man and began to walk away. She apologized in advance to Pietro for what was about to happen from this moment on. Upon hearing this, Pietro, who had his arms crossed, was somewhat surprised, not knowing what she was planning to do. She approached the reporters. Some had cameras and others were ready to jot down everything she said. To everyone gathered there, she asked them to listen to her story. She placed her hands over her abdomen and began walking toward them, and it didn't take long for the reporters to recognize her as Saintess Dolores, realizing that she had something to say about the incident. With a lost gaze, she put her hand inside her shirt and began to take out a notebook, thinking about the Night Bloodhound. The day before, the night of the explosion, Vicker took out this notebook, approached her and handed it to her, revealing that in it was the truth about the Quavati's family, and it depended on her how to use it. She placed her hands over her chest and began to observe it in silence. Back in the present, she took out the notebook and began showing it to the reporters. She opened the notebook, and with a furious gaze, started revealing the history of indulgence sales. Pietro, who was behind her, couldn't help but remain somewhat surprised. With a determined expression, she revealed that the sender was Quilty Rune Indulgentia, and the recipient was Cardinal Humbert Runer Qualatis. She explained that Viscount Bicoin had killed parents who wanted to donate their inheritance instead of passing it on to him, and had stolen the inheritance after disguising the death as an accident. all sins had been forgiven with the donation of 1.5 billion gold coins. Upon hearing this, Sancho, Piggy, and Tudor were left speechless. They could not believe what they had just heard. Dolores also revealed that Baron Lagiso had done something cruel to a maiden. He had killed her and secretly buried her in the sewer. All his sins had been forgiven with the donation of 200 million gold coins. And Sir Fingig had murdered his business partner to keep all the investment money. And all his sins had been forgiven with the donation of 800 million gold coins. Upon hearing this, Sinclair's and Bianca's attention focused on her. They could not go into shock. The reporters began talking among themselves. They were somewhat surprised. The brown-haired man couldn't believe that the church had sold indulgences to some demons. The brown-haired woman mentioned that they had crossed the line of forgiveness. The gray-haired man mentioned there was no way Cardinal Humbert and Quilty could have done such a thing. But the woman argued that the saintess was saying it directly. Dolores began to point at the date with her finger, revealing that Count Esesil had committed tax evasion close to 100 billion gold coins. But all his sins had been forgiven with a donation of 300 million gold coins. She was no longer willing to stop out of fear of her father. She wanted to become someone who would be ashamed of him. With a gaze full of determination, she revealed that she, Dolores Runer Quavatis, believed that sin was something that could neither be bought nor sold with money, and that the act itself was an insult to God. She swore not to forgive that more atrocities occurred in Quavatis. At the same time, not far from the area was the zone where the children played, and Vicar was sitting with his hands resting on the cement where he and Perry used to sit. He began to gaze at the sky and started thinking about the saintess. The sunlight was illuminating the tree. Even after regressing, her righteous mentality had not changed. Vicar began observing the rays of sunlight with a calm expression. With this, now 8 of the 10 elite corpses remained. Vicar's eyes filled with sadness, and as the leaves were blowing, he turned to one side. He rested his hand on the spot where Perry used to sit. He stood up and began to walk, vowing that at the end of this path, he would create a future where children like her could live with smiles. Next to the tree, there was a cross stuck in the ground, with flowers around it and Perry's name hanging on it. It was her grave. Vicar hoped that she could smile comfortably in heaven watching that future. This is the end of the video. If you guys want to see the next part, then don't forget to subscribe and like the video.